Hi, and we're back at the third segment, which is design and test. You remember the SBC flowchart, and we've talked about define, which is the first step. And now we're moving into the second step, which is design and test. I always like to think of my audience as wearing a button that says, how does this help me? So any intervention or any behavior we're trying to get people to change or do something new, imagine that person asking you back, how does this help me? And then it helps us really think more seriously about, is there some benefit in this for the audience? What is the change we want them to make? So the audience segment in our example is travelers on public buses, remember, who are not wearing masks. And the change that we want all the passengers on the public buses to make is to wear a mask all the time and correctly, so consistently and correctly when they're on the bus in order to reduce transmission of COVID-19 on buses. So the questions we have to ask, why are some people not wearing masks? What are their barriers? And dig deep to get into the bottom of why. Why are they not wearing masks? Maybe they don't have a mask. Maybe they don't have, they feel claustrophobic in a mask. Maybe they feel they don't believe COVID is real. Then each of those reasons, you dig deeper. The second point is, why are some people positive deviants? Why are some people wearing masks? What's the reason they do wear masks? Are they facing the same barriers as those who don't wear masks? And how did they overcome those barriers? If not, then what makes them wear the masks? It's as important to understand why people do practice a positive behavior as it is to understand why some people do not. So the steps to behavior change is something that is important to recognize, because not all of our audience is on the same step. Pre-knowledge, some people don't even know about COVID. They are not even aware that COVID can be stopped by wearing a mask. Knowledge. When they know about COVID, how it's transmitted, and perhaps know that masks are being recommended as a way not to pass COVID on from one person to another. Approval is of two kinds. One is approval of the method of protection. We're suggesting mask wearing as a way to protect yourself from COVID-19. So that is approval of the suggested solution. And once they approve that, they also have to think that the people around them approve or disapprove of this practice, right? Is it their social support, or do people make fun of people wearing masks and think they're weak, right? So social approval or community approval, approval from their peers is very important. As important as approval of the method or the intervention that we're asking people to perform. The next step is intention. And this is an interesting step, because you may know about the solution, you may agree that it might work, and you may think that people support you generally in wearing a mask, but do you intend to wear a mask yourself? So that's the next step, intending to wear a mask. But as we know, there's always a big gap between intention and practice, because you could intend to wear a mask, but it's a long way to practice. You may forget your mask. You may not have bought a mask yet. You may have left it as you left the house. When you get on the bus, you may realize there's a couple other people not wearing it. You want to wear it, but do you actually wear it? Too much of a bother, right? So those are all big gaps between intention and practice. And finally, once you practice it well enough, often enough, that it becomes a habit, you advocate for it. You tell other people, hey, I wear a mask. It protects me. You should wear one too. So self is at the middle. This is the sociological model. Again, looking at it, we are in the middle. Individual behavior is influenced by all these layers of the onion around it. Interpersonal relationships, partners, family, spouse, etc. The community we live in, leaders, providers who influence us. The enabling environment that we are in our countries or our cities or towns. What kind of policy legislations exist, the political and economic climate, religion, technology, natural environment, etc. And these are very much determined by government, NGO, and private sector. And through all of this, there is the information we get, the motivation, attitudes and beliefs, ability to act, which is the skills, self-efficacy and access, and the norms, perceived sociocultural gender norms. And these cut across all of the layers, influencing an individual's behavior and their ability to act. I want to delve into behavioral economics here for a second, because it hugely influences individual behavior. You may have heard of this. It's a fancy term, but it really is a new discipline, not so new anymore, which is an overlap between psychology and economics. And behavioral economics uses insights from both economics and psychology to more deeply understand how people form intentions and make decisions and take actions or not take actions. So when we think about the behavior steps to behavior change, behavioral economics tends to fall somewhere after approval and before advocacy. In the intention and practice phase is where the behavioral economics principles really strongly come into effect. The first, and there are many, many concepts within behavioral economics, and we'll just discuss a couple of them today, just to give you a sense of how it might work in the context of reproductive health. Framing is one of them. Imagine a painting that's been done by your three-year-old niece or nephew or kid, and it's a scrawl with lots of splashes around it. If you put the same painting in a fancy frame versus a very simple frame, it might be the difference between someone thinking it's modern art and someone thinking it's something your child gave you that you framed, right? And the painting is the same, except the way you framed the content is different to attach a different type of a value to it. This is an example of framing. You making the right choice or the choice that we want to guide people towards easier or more obvious to make it feel good, popular, attractive, simpler, etc. Right? You have two cans of yogurt. One says it contains 20% fat and the other one says it's 80% fat free. Right? Which one would you choose? Most likely the one on the right that says 80% fat free. Now, those of us who know simple mathematics clearly understand that there's no difference in the fat content between the two containers. However, it makes us feel better to choose the one that says 80% fat free, right? So this is simple behavior in economics, framing in action. In Nepal, for example, family planning used to be framed as two children are a blessing from God. Now, the modern generation is very much attuned to the word smart, whether it's a smartphone or smart decisions. And so using that or piggybacking on that, the new family planning slogan reads, family planning makes life smart. And in fact, in the Nepali text, the word smart is used as that word. And it's aspirational. It frames the same behavior of family planning in a positive way to help people feel better about that choice. So how do we design interventions that keep audiences at the core of it? Because we're not designing for ourselves. What we like may be something entirely different than what the audience wants to see. And we have to really keep them at the center of it. And this process is called human-centered design thinking. Human-centered design thinking at its core is a creative approach to problem solving. When we're little children, we are unafraid to be creative, right? And as we get older, we're afraid to make mistakes, afraid to be creative. We want to do things that we think are safe, right? And this approach really turns that on its head a little bit. It starts with people you're designing for. It's human-centered. And then it ends with new solutions that are tailor-made, that suit the needs of their needs, the audience's needs, not yours or mine. And why do we use human-centered design thinking? Because it brings together solutions which are desirable from a human point of view, and then what is technologically feasible, and economically viable. And when those three things intersect together, you have your sweet spot, right? And when they overlap, the desirable, feasible, and viable. Here's an example from real life. What we have here is an MRI machine. And as any of you who's been inside one of these will know that it doesn't feel that great. It's a little bit unnerving. It makes all these whooshing sounds, and you might feel a little claustrophobic. And if you and I feel this way, can you even imagine what it must feel like for a little kid? So one pediatric hospital really struggled with making this experience not so intimidating for young children. And so they undertook a human-centered design process, keeping the children at the center of the solution. And when they came up with ideas, what they finally came out with in the end was something quite phenomenal. It looked like this. It became a submarine. It was an exciting adventure that young people would be told a story, and you'd feel like you're going in, and the sounds and the whooshing was all incorporated into part of the story. So ultimately it felt more like an adventure rather than a medical procedure. And the kids were so excited to the last one. They said, oh, can we do it again? Right? So that transformed the experience for the young ones, instead of being something intimidating to being something fun. Pre-testing is extremely important when we come up with new designs, new ideas, and new interventions. And when you are presented with some ideas and say, oh, this is the campaign, the first question we need to ask ourselves is, was this pre-tested with the intended audience? Understanding the audience's reactions, their thoughts on what we're trying to do before implementation is really, really important. Pre-testing checks to see what has been designed is really suitable for the audience. It makes sure that the material is understandable, it's culturally appropriate, believable, realistic, acceptable to the audience, appealing, and motivational. And if we get it right after pre-testing, it saves us money, time, and energy. Because sometimes if you have ignored some of those major issues and it's culturally unacceptable or not really understood, we may end up wasting a lot of money producing something in its final form when it wasn't appropriate at all. This is an example from Northern Nigeria of two family planning posters. This is the Nori campaign, Nori supported campaign, and the government of Nigeria. It's a family planning campaign called No Talk Go. The three, know the facts about family planning, talk to your provider, partner about family planning, go for family planning, right? So here's the campaign that the posters that were pre-tested. And the one on the left is before pre-testing, and the one on the right is after pre-testing. While they may look exactly the same to you, there is a small but very important difference. Underneath the red jigsaw puzzle piece, the first one says, go for family planning. And the second one says, go for childbirth spacing. Now the difference is the word childbirth spacing versus family planning. Family planning was seen in this community as population control, and there was a lot of pushback, and it would have been unacceptable. But talking about it as childbirth spacing was acceptable. So pre-testing helps the project determine what was and was not acceptable. And it really saved the project a lot of resources to help them be accepted. So some key principles. This also includes partners, and you must include partners and stakeholders in the design process. So there's buy-in and ownership, and this is good for sustainability. You'll agree that unless there's partner buy-in and they feel like they've really been part of the process, it's not going to sustain. And how long can a project continue to put out materials unless, or campaigns or interventions, unless it's locally accepted and owned by the people who need to take it forward? So testing concepts and messages with audience partners and stakeholders is very, very critical. Being open-minded to and trusting the process and being willing to accept outcomes is also very, very important. We don't want to pretest just in a token way, but truly be willing to accept any changes that come or suggestions that come if we want to make this a better intervention. So now we get to our second exercise. We want to think about who the stakeholders are, other than the audience, that should be involved in this process. They could be parents, they could be caregivers, they could be politicians, they could be school officials, they could be religious leaders, it could be any more or combination of them. But it's important to think about who should be involved, right? It could be other family members as well. And what key benefits could you offer the audience? The benefits should be believable, relevant to the audience, and motivating. So here's an example of how you could frame it. In your example, you say, if the audience is girls 13 to 19 years old, your key benefit statement would read the following way. If you practice behavior X, so in this case, use a contraceptive method to avoid pregnancy, you can benefit by, the key benefit you're offering this young girl is finishing education on time and securing a future where you can earn well. So she's not just told prevent pregnancy by using a contraceptive method. She's also given a believable and powerful benefit to doing that. Now, this is one benefit. You may want to offer some alternate benefits as well and see which one resonates the most with young girls 13 to 19. And for that, you may need to pretest these key benefits. And whichever one has the most traction or is most understood or liked by the young girls would be the one to use to promote the behavior. So I will end there and let you take a little bit of time for exercise number two. Think about the adolescent girls and what you might offer them. I only offered one of the multiple possible key benefits. Perhaps you have other ideas. And this is something you could apply to any audience once you know what the desired behavior is that you want them to practice. So good luck with your second exercise.